Good morning, everyone. It's just 9 o'clock now, so we'll get started with our public accounts meeting this morning. We have witnesses here from the Department of Health, and our subject today is diabetes care and Nova Scotia renal programs. Before we begin with the opening statement from the Deputy Minister, I'd like to have the members of the committee introduce themselves, if we could, beginning with Mr. Ramey.
Good morning, and thanks for coming. Gary Ramey, member for Lunenburg West.
Matt Wynott, MLA Hammonds Plains, Upper Sackville.
Good morning, Clary McKinnon, MLA Pictou East.
Good morning and welcome, Howard Epstein, MLA for Halifax, Chibucto.
Good morning, Keith Caldwell, MLA for Preston.
Diana Whalen, I'm chair of the committee and also MLA for Halifax, Clayton Park. And during the meeting, I'll be leaving the chair and the vice chair will take over for the questioning period. If we could go to Ms. Evangeline Coleman-Satt.
Evangeline Coleman-Satt, Assistant Auditor General.
Darlene Henry, Committee Clerk.
Thank you very much. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Mr. McNamara, so that you can give us the opening statement for today.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Good morning. I'd like to start by introducing Catherine Fraser, who's on my left, who's Director of Acute and Tertiary Care at the Department of Health and Wellness. And on my right, Linda Penny, the Department's Chief Financial Officer, who are both here with me today. I am pleased to be here this morning to speak to you about the Department's provincial programs, the Nova Scotia Renal Program and the Diabetes Care Program of Nova Scotia. These two provincial programs advise the Department in developing or adopting clinical service standards to improve clinical care province-wide. They also provide advice on service delivery models and the impact of new technologies on patient care. Provincial programs work with the DHAs to support the implementation of guidelines and care standards to ensure a better health outcome for all Nova Scotians. These programs collect, analyze, and interpret disease information to understand the burden of disease in Nova Scotia. This understanding guides the Department's chronic disease strategy development. Both the renal program and the diabetes care program work with the goal of providing better health care to Nova Scotians with kidney disease and or diabetes by working with the service providers in all DHAs. They do not fund these service providers, but they do support their work by developing best practice, establishing guidelines of care, and promoting the uptake and monitoring and adherence to these guidelines. I will now take a moment to speak to each of these programs. The Diabetes Care Program helps to ensure that the staff working in diabetes centers across the province provide quality care that meets national and provincial guidelines. An example of this is the standardized testing to monitor for the development and progression of diabetes complications like kidney, eye, heart, and foot problems. The Diabetes Care Program has been one of the best provincial registries in Canada. And they use these statistics to inform provincial directions and guide local initiatives. Because of this data, we know what diabetes looks like at the provincial, district, and often community level, and can track changes in practice and referral patterns. They develop care guidelines for children, pregnant women with diabetes, and seniors with diabetes living in long-term care facilities. The Nova Scotia Renal Program works closely with renal service delivery programs in Capital, Cape Breton, Yarmouth, and the IWK Renal to improve renal health and care for all Nova Scotians. Through their work, they have standardized laboratory reporting and implemented a quality monitoring system in all labs throughout our province. This has improved the identification of kidney disease. The Renal Program has also developed guidelines and educational models to provide primary health care providers with the education and tools required to manage individuals who are at high risk of developing kidney disease, including guidelines on when they refer to kidney specialists. The program is also working to develop education and assessment standards to ensure that all individuals with end-stage kidney disease are provided with the same awareness on home therapies. Home therapy is dialysis in the convenience and comfort of your home on your own schedule. Individuals who choose home therapies have higher levels of patient satisfaction and quality of life. And it's, in recent studies, it's also said that they have less other chronic disease issues. After attending part of a cafe organized by the Nova Scotia Renal Program last week and hearing Dr. Tenekor from Ontario speak on the success of home therapy, I'm even more convinced we are on the right track to promote this. Government recently announced three critical priorities to make life better for Nova Scotians living with kidney failure. By addressing these areas, we're helping ensure capacity to meet the growing demand for services. These priorities are, first, 12 full-time registered nurses, or equivalent registered nurses, to satellite dialysis units across the province so that patients who require more complex care can receive it closer to home. The second priority is $626,000 to improve access to home dialysis treatment. Third is to invest $420,000 to support the planned expansion of the Dixon Building's dialysis unit. Even with serious financial challenges we face as a province, this year the government has announced over $2 million in investments to make life better for Nova Scotians with kidney failure and their families. To protect the function of your kidney, you must save your heart. High blood pressure can cause kidney damage, and kidney damage can cause high blood pressure. The interconnectivity is impossible to ignore. This is why the Diabetes Care Program of Nova Scotia, the Nova Scotia Renal Program, and Cardiovascular Health Nova Scotia have partnered to create the My Blood Pressure Initiative. I believe most MLAs had the opportunity to participate in this program a month or so ago. This program asked all Nova Scotians to have their blood pressure regularly monitored by a healthcare provider and to record and track their results. We have seen great success with launching this program province-wide this summer, and cards are available across our province. We are aware that as our population ages and people continue to choose more sedentary lifestyles, that need for support for chronic illness like kidney disease and diabetes will grow. Through the continued work of these two provincial programs, we know how much illness to anticipate and to encourage Nova Scotians to become more actively involved in their own wellness. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you. We look forward to answering your questions.
Mr. McNamara, thank you very much for your presentation. As you're aware, our tradition has been to allow each of the caucuses an initial round of 20 minutes each for questioning. We'll start with the Liberal Caucus, Ms. Whelan.
I think they have to find me. Thank you very much, and welcome today. I appreciate having the chance to go over some questions I have on the diabetic care. So for my first 20 minutes, I'm going to concentrate on the diabetes program. Thank you very much. And my first question relates to insulin pumps. As you know, I've had a bill before the House asking that the government look at insulin pumps. And I know it's been on the government's agenda anyway. It isn't something that's very important. I noticed that in the Nova Scotia Diabetes Statistics Report from 2011, it doesn't include statistics for those with diabetes who are under the age of 20. And it has a statement that says, that diabetes under the age of 20 is relatively rare. I wanted to get the right term, relatively rare. So I wonder if you could give me the number of people that you think have the need for juvenile insulin pumps in Nova Scotia.
I'm going to ask Catherine to answer that question.
If you could just repeat the question again, please.
Well, let's start with just how many diabetics in Nova Scotia would be under the age of 18? Let's start with just the number of juvenile diabetics.
I think we have about 705 that are under the age of 19.
Okay, that gives us a relative sense. I think I saw a figure of 77,000 Nova Scotians
yes,
have diabetes.
Absolutely.
So certainly
yes.
that would verify the relatively rare statement that you had in there. Given that we have such a well-developed province-wide diabetes care program, which you did allude to in your opening statement, and that gives us an extensive network of diabetic centers across the province, is it your opinion that we're better prepared to deliver a province-wide insulin pump program than other provinces?
I think that with the Diabetes Care Program of Nova Scotia, we do have some of the infrastructure in place to support that. The piece that we would need to enhance would be at the provider level, because as you know, Diabetes Care Nova Scotia is a provincial program that supports providers, and they provide support through guidelines and standards and surveillance of the of people with diabetes, but it's actually the diabetes care centers across the province, and there are 39 of them,
right,
that deliver the services. So within those multidisciplinary teams, there would need to be some enhancement in terms of training so that they in turn could help families and children who would be on an insulin pump know how to use it and be there for support if they had issues with the pump.
Right. Thank you, Ms. Fraser. So what you're saying is there's a good network in place, but we need training.
Yes.
We would need training.
Yes. And that would require resources to provide that training to the staff that are in place.
Okay. I wonder if the Deputy Minister could confirm whether there was any background analysis completed or recommendations from previous Ministers of Health around a publicly funded insulin pump program, if in the past, in the previous government, if there had been any recommendations.
Not that I'm aware of, but that...
Okay.
I think that we're...
Ms. Fraser?
Thank you. I think we're, with previous governments, we did do some work in exploring the issue, but there was never a formal ask or put forward by the department.
I wonder if today, if we'd had the manager for the diabetic care program here, if there might be a bit more information available on that. So maybe it's a question we could pose.
So what is your question? That
I really wanted to know if there'd been any firm information or recommendations made under previous ministers about preparing for insulin pumps.
No, I think as Catherine alluded to, the program would report through her and she'd be aware if there had been one.
Okay, thanks. I've got quite a few questions, so I'm going to run along to the next one. There's a document called Priming for Pumps. That's the name of it, Priming for Pumps document. And that, I believe it was provided in our packages, I think so. But anyway, we've seen it. Some diabetic centers would need support for insulin pump therapy or a referral route, while others will not initiate pump therapy, but will do follow-up. And so given what it said there, I'm asking whether or not, given that adults and young children are using insulin pump therapy right now across the province, have been for some time, why would we have diabetes centers that are not going to be able to support the insulin pumps? Because that report, Priming for Pumps, says some will support it, some will not, and there are, you said, 39 in the province, so...
I'm not exactly sure which report you're referring to, but anyway, in the case of Nova Scotia, we have looked at insulin pumps. The recommendation at this point is not to proceed with adding insulin pumps to our program. We have other programs in our place that provide adequate service to youth at an affordable price. And for us to move into this, we have to consider any expenditure against other priorities.
All right, so that's pretty definitive. Do you have all the information that you need right now to move forward if you chose to, if funding were available to move forward with insulin pumps?
Well, it's not just a case of funding. It's also a case of what's the right method of providing insulin to individuals. Some individuals would not be appropriate for insulin pumps even if the program was available. But we do know that there are others that would be. It is a factor of convenience. We know that. We do know that it is a factor that can assist in a better lifestyle for some children. But we also know that in other cases, it is not the best therapy to use.
Yeah, I don't believe it's good for everybody either. I don't think all 700 children that were mentioned, for example, would be candidates for that. But those that have received it, you know, absolutely swear by the fact that their quality of life is you know, many times better than it was before, and that their peace of mind is so much higher for parents of children with the need for insulin. So, I just think that it's something that we can't arbitrarily turn our backs to. We should be looking looking at a way to achieve it.
We're not arbitrarily turning our back on this. We're doing it. We've done an assessment. The advice we've received to date is not to proceed with it based on the existing programs we have in place and other priorities we have to address.
And other provinces, though, are moving forward. So that should add more credence to the fact that Nova Scotia should be looking at it.
And some things we're doing in Nova Scotia, other provinces are not. Our Diabetes Care Center is far and wide better than any program in any other province. Other provinces are starting to emulate us.
You know, which is why I think we're well prepared to introduce a program like the insulin pump support. I have some questions on drugs, so I'd like to go to the question of the drug Lantus. Could you please inform us how many jurisdictions in the country do provide funding for Lantus, which is a diabetic drug?
Yeah. Ms. Fraser.
I don't have that answer of how many provinces have gone to it, but again, in Nova Scotia, we have been taking the advice through the Common Drug Review, where Lantus is not one that's being recommended to be on the formulary. Although we do know that it may in the future be something that we should look at for a particular patient population.
Okay, and that makes sense. I mean, in each one of these drugs, there's a certain group that it's best for. It's just the same as the pumps. It's not for everybody. I'm just looking at this based on the calls that I receive when I was health critic, and also, you know, we receive in our caucus office as well, that there's quite a demand for that. I'm wondering if you can tell me if there's been calls received at the department as well, any kind of concerted effort from diabetics asking for access to this drug.
Mr. McNamara. We're receiving a lot of lobbying on that particular drug. Many other drugs, I know we get a lot of lobbying.
Okay, I know that. I know you do. But I think this one is coming to the fore, so yeah. I guess that's something to expect.
But I would also add that if we had extra dollars, we probably would go with that over the insulin pumps.
Okay, well, that's positive for people who are looking for Lantus then. What I was going to mention was that if you're receiving the drug Lantus, there seems to be less need for testing strips. I think it's because it's a long-lasting insulin. And I wondered if the department has factored in the reduced cost associated with testing strips when they're determining whether Lantus should be available through the pharmacare programs.
We know that test strips are overused in this province based on the lobbying by drug companies, and that is a program that, through the education of our diabetes care program, we are using the lowest number of test strips in the country right now for our diabetic population, but we do have to put programs in place to reduce it even further.
Okay. Another drug that I think is on the formulary is Januvia, which is also a diabetic drug, and maybe Ms. Fraser knows that better. It said it was added to the formulary in October. And certainly that's a good thing. It's part of the array of it. But Januvia is made available in the case when insulin no longer works. When I was reading that, I was actually surprised that there is a drug that you can use in that instance. But I wanted to make the point that Lantus is less expensive than Januvia. And so from a patient perspective, a lot of doctors are saying it should be the next drug available in the array of choices for type 2 diabetics. So I wanted to ask, if Lantus is cheaper than Januvia and requires fewer test strips, then why is Lantus not being funded now? But we have moved to Januvia, which is a more expensive drug.
Ms. Fraser.
I can't answer that, but I will certainly investigate it for you and provide a response.
Okay, that would be good. Are you aware whether Lantus is covered by most private insurance plans?
No, I'm not.
So perhaps you could compare that too. And I just was checking another one. Do you know if it's provided for Aboriginals that are covered under the non-insured health benefit, the federal government? So it would be available if you lived on one of the First Nations.
No, I don't know that either, but I will take down the question. And
because I think it is, and you know, in which case I'd say there is a population in Nova Scotia that has access to it. And again, that adds further, I think, rationale to look at it on a cost basis and on the basis that other Nova Scotians are receiving it. So on the fairness basis, I would say.
Now that you're speaking about it, I do remember that, yes, people who have private insurance can access long-acting insulin, the Lantus.
Yeah. Do you have a medical committee that would be advising you as well on these drugs?
The Pharmacare, yes.
Yeah, because I think that there's some strong medical evidence that this is an important step in the treatment options that should be available to diabetics. And again, when I looked at it, the fact that it has the long lasting aspect, that it's cheaper than other drugs that we're funding, that it was something we should be considering. I'd like to ask you a little bit about the diabetic test strips, and I know, Mr. McNamara, you just mentioned that we have, you think we're well managed in that regard. A couple of, not even 2 years ago, February 2010, the provincial government made the announcement that they were going to limit the number of diabetic test strips that would be eligible to be covered. They were going to be limited to 100 per year. At the time, there had been an alarm in the diabetic community. The Canadian Diabetes Association contacted the government, and the decision was reversed. Could the deputy please indicate that who made the recommendation in February 2010, and was it the bureaucracy or the diabetic care program itself?
It was made through with the advice support from the diabetes care program. And there was a review and an evaluation done. It was based on a report that was done nationally. What ended up happening is we get outmaneuvered by the drug company, to be quite honest, who used vulnerable patients and the Canadian Diabetes Association, who they fund heavily, to outlobby us. It is a multi-million dollar industry to the drug company.
Test strips.
Across this country. So, as I mentioned, we've gone through another route of going through education to reduce them significantly. So now we're the lowest user per capita of people with diabetes, but mm-hmm. we still have to go further. And even the Canadian Diabetes Association recently has come out with a new report reducing the number of test strips that they're recommending that be used versus their position of 2 years ago.
My concern would be if people are being responsible and on top of their disease and managing it well, they would be testing regularly, and that would prevent them from coming to emergency rooms or having a lot of other adverse incidents that might happen if they're not on top of it. So, it seems counterintuitive to limit the number of strips.
But the evidence shows, there are certain people that do not have to test at all that do. There are certain people, for example, I know that test to see if they can have another drink. That isn't appropriate use of test strip, if you think of it from a medical point of view. There are individuals who, that doesn't mean we don't test. We test appropriately. We use them to test for that, for their health, not because they just want to test to record something, and not use the information to better look after themselves.
Right. Just as a final question, is the reduction of the coverage for test strips under active consideration for the next budget year?
I would say it is under active consideration based on the recent report from the Canadian Diabetes Association. Yes.
Okay, so that'll be something to revisit then in the future. I wanted to ask you about the classroom policy for children. Again, that's been an issue, and I've had the opportunity to meet quite a few parents around the province and get a sense of their concern about the children in the classroom and just, how they manage their day and what kind of supports are in place. And we know that there was a new guideline document, Guidelines for Supporting Students with Type 1 Diabetes in Schools, that came out, and that was just November 2010. And from discussions with parents in the meantime, they did say at the start of this school year there was just as much, I don't know if chaos is going a little far, but uncertainty certainly, and a lack of consistency still in place, not only across the province but within single school boards, individual school boards. Not every school is doing it the same way. And that was one of the things that I know the guideline was intended to correct, was that we would then have a standard in place that every school would maintain. So I wanted to know, one thing I'd like to ask for would be if you could give us copies of the agreements that are in place with schools. I don't know if it was with individual schools or school boards, but I know that agreements were to be signed, and I'd like to be able to see that, and I think other members of the committee as well. We all represent ridings with, children and families that are affected by diabetes, so we'd really like to see that.
That, I believe, is a program through the Department of Education, and we will request that from them.
Okay.
And forward it to you.
That was actually one of my questions, was who's really monitoring it? So are they monitoring the rollout of it? It was a Department of Health guideline, I think, though.
Yes. Ms. Fraser.
the Department of Health worked with the Department of Education to advise on the guideline, but the guideline is implemented through the Department of Education. And it's interesting because we often hear from families who are having concerns, and we haven't heard anything in the last little while, I would say, about that.
So having helped to draft these guidelines, things have been calm in your estimation, at least based on complaints?
Yes, and we do, from time to time, have conversations with education about how this is going. And from what we've heard in the last, I would say, few months, it's been going quite smoothly.
Okay. Well, that is, that's not what we're hearing on our end in terms of calls to my constituency and to the caucus office. So I think it'd be great if perhaps another question would be just to ask you to review it. Not only would I like to see the agreements that are in place between school boards and the DHAs, because I thought it was school boards and DHAs that had signed that, but if you could also, you know, perhaps give us an update on the status of it. Because again, every fall, it's a real worry to parents whose yes. children require monitoring, and even for the school administration, they're often unprepared or nervous about what needs to be done. And I know that we can integrate children and they can participate fully if they have the right supports. So that's very important to us. Could I ask, Mr. Chair, how much time I have left in my timing?
Just under 2 minutes.
Still. Oh, very quick. I wanted to go quickly to the islet transplant, which is a pancreatic kind of transplant that can actually free people from the need to take insulin. I had one person who's been here at the legislature, and I read a resolution for him who went over a year and a half ago. It might almost be going on 2 years. He went to Edmonton where the transplant is done and has been actually insulin free after that. And he is somebody who had brittle diabetes, which meant that brittle diabetes means it's very difficult to control even with the most stringent efforts. And this has just been an absolute lifesaver for him. It's changed everything for his life. I wanted to ask whether or not there's any consideration about offering the transportation and support that we give to other people going away for transplants if they were to go for the islet transplant.
So the department does have an out-of-province travel policy. And I would have to review it again to see if it would include these people who need to travel for that type of surgery. It's not one that I think we have supported in terms of having it done in our own province. And I think the clinical evidence on it is still not clear on the long-term benefit.
It is in Alberta now a standard of care, using those terms that are common in your department, and they've done now, I know over 100 of these. It's also important to note there'd be very few Nova Scotians that would be candidates, again, going back to the fact that not every one of these, procedures or drugs work with everybody. There's only a few people that would really benefit from this. You have to be healthy, you have to meet a whole standard of other criteria, but it's been really phenomenal.
Time.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move now to a second round of 20 minutes, and we go to the PC caucus, Mr. D'Entremont.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. It's a pleasure to have the Department of Health in once again and talk about two very important programs in our province. My first, basically looking around the education aspect of diabetes care in this province, because as we know, as our population continues to age, more and more people are being diagnosed with, a type 2 diabetes. How are we going to be taking on this larger influx of people, because we know it gets worse and worse every year, and how are we going to work on sort of earlier intervention programs to make sure that they don't get any worse as time rolls on?
I guess, as you know, from even your days as minister, we have a very active group of diabetes education centers around our province. Mm-hmm. We also know that a number of them also travel out to smaller communities, individuals that will go, for example, I learned this morning that for example, in the Sheet Harbor area, they'll travel to Ecom Secom to see individuals in that community. And this happens in other places. For example, people from Yarmouth travel to Shelburne to provide that education in addition to our fixed centers. And what we have to do, also the many individuals get advice from their own family physicians, nurse practitioners, and others. And we do provide information to them through various ways. We also try to have a medical advisor in each district who advises the physicians in the community of how to advise their patients who have diabetes that are in an unfortunate situation of maybe not being able to travel, et cetera. But it is something we have to be very active and will continue. And our program, I think, as I mentioned earlier, we're the best in the country in having diabetes education centers and with our standards, and we'll just continue to enhance them. And with the great leadership of the people in that program, we're very fortunate.
Do we find that the family physicians are understanding the full program, allowing for that referral to happen? Are they counseling as well the patients on lifestyle changes and things like that? Or is it more, they're sort of just washing their hands of it as they send it off to the program, or are they staying very involved in the care of that patient?
I can speak as from two roles, first being a former chair of the Diabetes Care Program in Nova Scotia and also being a CEO in a district. There are certain physicians who embrace it and do a very good job. There are other physicians who, like any of us in life, aren't as embracing of the program. But our job is to continue to promote to physicians how they can assist their patients. And the majority of physicians, nurse practitioners, and others are good people who want to do the right job and will provide that education.
No, because what I would worry about sometimes is that sort of a washing your hands of it, that once you do refer off to the program, then it's, not my issue anymore kind of thing. So I just, hope that circle continues to flow along. And I don't know if you, that's sort of my last comment on that one, but if you want to cap off before I go on to my next couple of points.
Okay,
it's all good. The last point I want to talk about the diabetes program really is the issue that the previous member just brought up, was the issue of test strips. And I mean, this is one, a very odd discussion. Really, what happens is because you have the department sort of saying one number, and you have other groups saying other numbers. The best I've been able to find talking to people that I sit and have breakfast with or have coffee with, and I ask them, it's a standard question now, and I see they take out the little pack, is how many strips a day do you use? And I get a ranging number from anywhere from a couple to nine, sort of in that range. So what is the appropriate number on this? I know three sounds a little low, but, where is the associations or organizations, where are they starting to push things towards?
I guess it's fair to say that there's no magic number, but we do know that some individuals have to test more frequently than others, depending on the severity of their diabetes. But the problem is that strips have become a marketing tool of the drug companies. And for example, even when you go into a drugstore, you can get the free machine, and then the strips are sold.
Yeah, I heard that this week, and it shocked me.
So it's a, and also even if you look at the recent study by the Canadian Diabetes Association, it was funded by the seller I'm sorry, that was the pump one. But they're all funded by the drug companies in different ways, which creates issues for us. And I met this past week with one of the drug companies who was surprised that we were going to look at test strips again. They believe that that they can continue to market and sell, and that would be and it is a big profit center for drug companies. Unfortunately, they're in a different business than we are. We're in providing good care. They're in a marketing business to make the most money.
I thank you for that. And I'm just wondering too that if through discussions with drug companies, if there's a better medium to find. I mean, you can't necessarily cast them out completely because they are the provider of that product. So just wondering if in your discussions with them, is there an understanding of where your position is on this?
They know our position and have been very honest with them. Mm-hmm. Again, where they come from is a different, they're coming from a different part of the landscape, i.e. the shareholders. Yeah. We're coming for trying to provide for a appropriate patient care and at the same time trying to protect the taxpayer. And so what we do is base our information on the best evidence that we can get, whether it's based on reports done nationally and also the work that we do. But I think the education work that's been done in Nova Scotia through the diabetes education centers and through the advice from our nephrologist, we've done a much better job on test strips.
Okay, and if there's any last comment that goes with it, is that if we are going to be changing this down the road, to make sure we do the communication piece and make people understand what's going on before the sort of the ball drops. Because I think that's what happened last time. There was, you know, all of a sudden, and we're hearing that there was only three allowed a day, or, you know, the 100 per year. That didn't make a whole lot of sense to anybody. So it's just, again, a bigger communication issue.
No, I admit we screwed up the last time and made it open over.
No, thank you for that. While I'm staying on diabetes for a second, is the issue of pumps, and I can say that, you know, when I was minister, we did ask for some work to be done to get the data at least ready to look at those younger users of this product, and you know, at the other night when we were at the dinner, the father that was presenting about getting this pump for his daughter. Actually said it very well, is that how can a little thing that looks the size of a pager cost $6,000? And I think that's an issue that where you're going with the test strips is kind of the same issue with an insulin pump, is why does this cost so much, and why do they continue to market it that way? And we've gone along into time on this one, and the prices have remained the same. So that doesn't seem to be fair to a patient to see that kind of product, that we can buy a cell phone that does all these wonderful things for $150, and yet an insulin pump that seems to have the same kind of technology built into it, except maybe a few extra pumps and pieces, that costs $6,000. So any thoughts on that, or have you had any discussions with some of these providers to say, you know, come on, let's see what can be done?
Well, we haven't had it on the insulin pumps because there hasn't been a willingness to change, as far as I'm aware. I mean, we do that with some of the drug companies and some of the prescriptions that we do work our way through. We are also even working with some of the drugs that was mentioned earlier, is looking at how we can do things better on a national basis. And we've been doing some negotiations on a couple of drugs, which has had a success on one. Another, it's still in the works. But I mean, I think there's a lot more work that we've talked about from a minister's basis and from a deputies across the country, how we can start doing things better together. And if we look at the prices that we pay for some of these things versus the U.S. as well, and we have to say, how can we get U.S. prices for some of these devices?
No, and I think that's a good comment for many of the products and services that are provided by the health department, because, you know, we are a small province and we belong to a larger country. So, you know, why can't we do things a little more together on these things? And that's always a difficult thing to do. My last line of questioning for this round, and I probably won't use up my 20 minutes, but I will finish up with this, because I'm basically sitting in for the member for Hans West. I'm going to have to ask the questions around a dialysis unit for Windsor. So I'm just wondering, you know, have you been aware of the issue? And I'm sure you have, but, you know, what kind of approaches have you had, and what kind of discussion have you had around a dialysis unit for Windsor?
Okay, we're very aware of the issue that's been raised in Windsor, and it's unfortunate that a number of individuals do have to travel for dialysis. We also, looking at our around the province, we are trying to enhance programs first shore up the ones that we have at the current time, which is why we added the additional registered nurses in those current satellite. We've also had some reviews done, and we know that Windsor would not be at the top of the list. There are some other areas that are people have to travel much further, for example, Digby. And so we have to look at prioritizing. Secondly, in terms of and I know that the community has started to raise some funds, as I believe has Shelburne, in the same vein. But again, the department has to develop its priorities based on the need. And if we based it on funding, we'd have a hospital in different places, as you can guess.
We already
guess.
Do.
Pardon me?
We already do.
We have a few of them. That's correct. but I think the thing that we have to look at, and I mentioned in my opening remarks, is home dialysis. And this is something I think could be tremendously beneficial to some of the individuals that are in the Windsor area, where they could do it in their own home. Some of it can be done at night. Some can be done during the day. And I just, and so we are starting to concentrate how we can do promote home dialysis more. We know that at roughly 80% of the individuals receiving dialysis currently could have home dialysis, which is a much cheaper form of doing it. It's also more convenient for the patients, and it also gives them a better lifestyle. But our culture has been to institutionalize it, and so it's going to take a bit of time to change it. But that's one way, even with the funds that are being raised in Windsor, could go towards a number of units to help us do some home dialysis.
I think the discussion around home dialysis, too, is how frequent the person is going to have to be doing it. I mean, sometimes it's up to three times a day where they're having to hook themselves up to the home dialysis unit. I've heard things, so maybe I'll ask the question. Home dialysis, how does it affect the lifestyle? How many times do they have to be hooked up? How many times do they have to go through the process or the procedure of dialysis when they're at home? And then I'll go to the next piece.
Ms. Fraser?
So there's three types of home therapy, and one of them is home hemo, which some patients choose to do that at night, so we call it nocturnal dialysis, and so they would hook themselves up at night. We also have two types of peritoneal dialysis, and one of them is, as you say, you do it more often during the day, but again, the second type of peritoneal dialysis uses what we call a cycler, and that can be done at night as well when people sleep. So I think we haven't socialized home therapies as well as we could, and as we look around the country in terms of what BC is doing and now what Manitoba is doing and Ontario, we're realizing that we have an opportunity here to allow people to stay home, especially frail elderly who are trying to travel for these treatments, and give them more freedom and quality of life.
Well, I think, too, is you might have a bit of a catch-22 there, especially if you're, you know, an older patient. You know, you're not comfortable with hooking yourself up to a system like that, and you're not comfortable with actually driving to the hospital site. So it's I can understand the challenge of trying to sell the idea of home dialysis. I've seen the announcements that you have made in trying to move forward on that one. But of course, I wish you luck on that one. But the other issue is that we still hear of too many people traveling in too many different directions in order to receive dialysis. You know, South Shore is no different. I mean, you know, the deputy and I have had that discussion many times on the issue of Liverpool versus Bridgewater. And I know that in the Valley, it's always, I think, with Middleton versus Kentville, and now Windsor thrown into the mix. But ultimately, we do have a community that's, you know, waiting for some answers, and I know probably haven't received the ones that they wanted, but I don't think I've had a meeting with them not so long ago, but they don't seem to be wanting to back down. So more bringing the heads up that I don't think that one's going to go away for some time, like many of the other sites haven't gone away in it. Well, where else in the province are we looking at right now for future expansion? I saw the added nurses that we're going to be hiring, and maybe some expansion here at the Dixon Center, but, you know, where else do we see some movement in the province right now on dialysis?
Well, there is, as I mentioned, Digby is one that we have to look at for the future as we do our future planning and as funds become available. I think Bridgewater, as you mentioned, is another obvious area for a couple of reasons. There is, as we're opening up the new facility in Truro, it does have the opportunity for expansion in the future if the need grows. So at least that's was one some forethought put into that part of it. So not that it would be expanded immediately, but at least the idea is there. And so that's three off the top of my head that come out. But also what we're doing at Capital Health is not just to look at the provincial, but also to provide us more opportunity to be able to train people for home dialysis, the same as we're doing in Yarmouth. And also I should have mentioned in my comments, Inverness, as we're going through the work there, will provide opportunities for additional spaces as well.
And basically a final question is sort of the age and quality of the dialysis units themselves, of actually the machines, because I remember when I was minister, we had the opportunity to go through the Dixon Center, and of course the earful that I got was on the amount of hours that were actually on the dialysis machines themselves. I'm just wondering how the replacement of machines has been going, and you know, what's kind of our average age going on right now of equipment.
I'll ask Catherine to answer that.
Yeah, Ms. Fraser?
I can't tell you the exact age of the equipment, but I can tell you that we have been replacing equipment over the past 2 years based on what Capital Health's needs are and what Cape Breton's needs and Yarmouth's needs are.
And if I remember correctly, an average price of one of those is somewhere around 40-odd thousand or 60-odd thousand, sort of in that range?
Okay. Yes.
All right. Thank you very much.
And that's all the questions
that's all
you have,
I have
right now? Okay. Then we'll move to Mr. Ramey for the NDP. 20 minutes starting now.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for coming here today, Mr. McNamara, also Ms. Penny and Ms. Fraser. I guess everybody knows that there are two types of diabetes, type 1, type 2. Certainly the people on this committee know that. I'm interested in knowing if you have any statistics as to how many new diabetics get diagnosed each year with type 2.
I do have it here on a cheat sheet. I think it's around 2,000, but I'll just check here.
Perhaps I'll, while you're looking for that, I don't want to lose too much of my time here.
No, you go ahead.
But when you get the number, I'd like to know it. I guess my second question would be, I've heard that studies that suggest that we are, Nova Scotians, are among the most unhealthy people in Canada in terms of our smoking rates, in terms of our weight, in terms of some of our unhealthy lifestyle issues. Is that true or false?
We know as a fact that we have one of the highest rates of chronic diseases in the country, which includes diabetes. Some of it comes from lifestyle factors, some of it comes from genetics, and some of it, I mean, the unfortunate part, though, is we do have to address it, and that's why through the health promotion and protection side, we're trying to do more to be preventative as we're looking at a go-forward basis. Mm-hmm. We also know that if we don't start doing more on the prevention side, we will not be able to afford to treat all the people who are going to be impacted by chronic diseases.
Understood. So, do you have the number yet?
Yes. It's 4,000.
How much is
4,000 newly diagnosed?
Wow.
Yeah,
so
it's big.
We're going at the rate of 4,000 new diagnosed diabetics a year.
Yeah.
Is that added to the whatever the figure was in 77,000?
Well,
did somebody
say? We have 80,000.
We have 80,000.
80,000. People living with diabetes in
currently
the province right now.
And we're adding 4,000 a year at the present time to the 80,000?
Yes.
That's huge.
Yes.
Okay, so in relation to the question that Mr. McNamara just answered, which was about our chronic disease rates and some of the other issues that we have, whether it's genetic or whether it's lifestyle, do we have any kind of, statistics that would tell us how much, by what percentage we think we could reduce type 2 diabetes if we could do the preventative stuff that we just alluded to? Is there any speculation on how much we could cut that down if we had, you know, some kind of preventive programs to keep us from getting overweight and to keep us from being as sedentary?
Mr. McNamara?
That's, as I said, that's one of the things we're trying to do by trying to promote more. We know that, for example, that individuals who walk can reduce all kinds of chronic disease, or all number of chronic diseases.
Right.
And I think if I remember the statistics, 30 minutes a day will do is a big prevention. And but again, I don't want to imply that we're blaming people for their own illnesses. In some cases, they come for different reasons. But as with type 2, there is opportunity to at least delay the onset mm-hmm. or to minimize the impact of it. And when we talk about the number of individuals diagnosed with diabetes, it doesn't mean that they're all insulin treated with insulin. I mean, some are treated by diet. Some are, can be treated by exercise and diet. There's different ways to get at these individuals. And I think the better job we can do on the promotion side, and we're going to have to, as I mentioned, to reduce the impact. And as many of us are getting older, it's also more imperative that we start to do more preventative.
I certainly hear you on that. I would argue that as Nova Scotians, as individuals who are living in Canada, that we all, you know, we are responsible to a certain extent for our own health. I think we're responsible to a very high degree for our own health, and we best start paying attention. On the type 1 diabetes front, my wife's a type 1 diabetic with an insulin pump, so I'm not unfamiliar with insulin pumps and some of the issues around them. However, I do watch what my wife has to do in order to use the insulin pump properly, which means that every time she looks at a plate of food that she's going to eat, she analyzes very quickly in her head everything that's on there and knows instantly how many carbs, how many this, how many that. Then she programs the insulin pump to give her the appropriate amount of insulin. And if she were to come in here and walk around the city with me for a while, that would change everything if she didn't do the exact same walk every day. So using an insulin pump, in my opinion, is a very complicated intellectual exercise that I don't think everybody's capable of performing. Now, that's just my opinion, so I'm not trying to make a profound statement here of any kind. I'm just saying, from what I've seen, that is a serious issue, which I would argue if you had any kind of irresponsible person, and I'm talking adult or child, who doesn't pay an awful lot of attention to what they're doing, they could end up in a horrible mess using an insulin pump. I do believe a lot of people think it's the pancreas attached to the outside of your body that's hooked to your brain somehow, and that automatically tells the insulin pump what to do, which it clearly doesn't. So I would like to hear a little bit more on that. I'm not anti-insulin pump. Obviously, I just indicated my wife has one. However, I'm very concerned about how insulin pumps would be used by people who aren't totally on top of their game. So do you have any comment around that? I know you said a while ago, somebody said over there, they're not for everybody. I totally agree with that. But can you say a little more on it?
Ms. Fraser?
Thank you. You're quite right. We have had advice from endocrinologists from the IWK and from other district health authorities. And again, you need to be very careful of who is the appropriate patient for an insulin pump. And there are patients who feel that they would rather not have one because, again, it reminds them of their diabetes every day to be attached to a device. But it is exactly that, a device that can support and manage diabetes and provide a quality of life for those who are willing to take on the work of understanding how this pump works and how to use it properly. And so, it's not for everyone.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to switch gears for a second here, and I don't want to chew up all the time myself for my group here, but just a couple of questions on dialysis, just a couple of quick ones. Mr. D'Entremont was talking about dialysis, and he twigged my curiosity when he was talking about, elderly people and so on. And I know a lot of the dialysis patients are elderly. Do you have any statistics on the average age of a dialysis patient by any chance over there?
64, 65.
Mr. McNamara, yeah.
64, 65.
Okay, so around the 60 somewhere then. Okay, that's interesting. And the other question I had on that was about drugs drugs that are available, I take it that dialysis patients need medications as well. What are the medications that that dialysis patients need?
Do you want to speak to that?
Ms. Fraser?
So dialysis patients can be on a number of medications, but one that they usually take is called Aranis, or I can't remember the other trade name, but it's erythropoietin, and that drug is provided for them.
It's covered by their health plans or whatever, by the government?
By the government, yeah.
Okay. The other question was in relation, again, to something Mr. Dontremont alluded to in relation to, I think, Mr. Porter, who he's sitting in for today, and that's, you know, the locations of the, where are the satellite units located? I know we have several, and I think you maybe listed them already, or I know you mentioned one or two, but where, can you tell me where they are?
So if we start around the province, we have one in Liverpool, mm-hmm. one in Berwick, one in Truro, Pictou, Spring Hill, Antigonish, and Strait Richmond, and soon there'll be one in Inverness.
Okay.
Oh, in Sherbrooke. Sorry, Sherbrooke as
so
well.
So there's quite a few. There's quite a few already, and but I still know there are. And I of course admit that there are travel issues because that's something the diabetes questions that were being referred to a while ago by Ms. Whalen. She gets lots of calls. I don't get those at all. I do get calls on dialysis. And I guess one of the questions I wanted to ask just before I hand off to my colleagues here is when you're looking at where you might have to go next, and I know Mr. McNamara alluded to some places, I think he mentioned Digby and perhaps even Bridgewater, which would be, you know, that'd be great. But do you look at the... at the demographics of these places, for instance, Bridgewater, I'll use it as an example because it's my town, it's in my constituency, it's growing like crazy. The population keeps going up because many people who left there to work in what used to be the West, which was Ontario at the time, and went to the car plants and so on, when I was much younger, which was quite a while ago, they are now retiring, selling their houses in Mississauga and Oakville and Oshawa, for many hundreds of thousands of dollars and coming back and buying properties on the South Shore, but they tend to be my age and older, and I just got the average age for dialysis. Mm-hmm. So my concern is, do you look at the demographics and how the demographics of the province seems to be changing when you look at possible locations for these new satellites?
Mr. McNamara.
Sure. Demographics, when the original ones were set up, I was looking at also distance. And so, for example, the one in Liverpool would cover individuals not just from Bridgewater, but down towards Shelburne. So so if you look at the distance in terms of traveling, mm-hmm. ones from Mahone Bay towards Halifax would obviously probably come to Halifax. So if you look at, that was one of the decisions. Yes, as we look at new things, we look at the demographics of what we're doing. That's why consideration for Bridgewater come on. Also, where individuals are now coming from who require dialysis, the age of the population is another thing that we look at. But again, we still have to look at those, and the reason I use Digby is because it's the farthest people have to travel at the moment, either to Yarmouth or to the Valley, which is longer than anyone else, and if you think of the winter roads, and so trying to minimize. But also, as we can do more home dialysis, we can probably start reducing our reliance on some of our institutional in the future as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, and now I'll hand it off to Mr. McKinnon.
Mr. McKinnon, your turn. And I would mention that in the second round, we're going to have 20 minutes because the Conservative representatives weren't able to stay today. So we'll have lots of time to come back to Mr. Ramey.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I would like to zero in for a moment on our 13 First Nations that we have around the province. And I realize that the federal government has so many involvements and so many aspects of First Nation lives. But I'm wondering, with the level of diabetes that there is on the First Nations, and in the First Nation in my constituency, Pictou Landing First Nation, I have some very, very good friends there that are dealing with diabetes, and the The populations on First Nations certainly growing, and I'm very concerned about the levels that exist. And are we doing anything education-wise, service-wise to our First Nations?
Perhaps I'll start and I'll ask Catherine to add the more technical part. I had the opportunity a couple of weeks ago to appear before the Senate Committee in Ottawa. And one of the things I talked about was the role of Health Canada in the Aboriginal community. And for example, it becomes sometimes the resort of who's the last payer to look after the individual. And there's not clear guidelines on where Health Canada has its role and where we, and sometimes it leaves the individual out in the cold, which is unfortunate. And we have to recognize that they are all citizens of our country and our province. And we have to figure out a better way to know who does what, when, and where. And so that's, and I really believe strongly that we haven't done a good job between both governments of defining our roles of where things fit in. With that, I'll ask Catherine maybe to talk about what we do do. Okay.
Yeah. Ms. Fraser.
Some of our provincial programs have had a relationship with various First Nation communities across the province, and I think that the Dwegan Partnership, which are the three First Nations communities in Cape Breton, have been involved with three of our provincial programs. But at the end of the day, treatments that First Nations communities receive in our acute care facilities, that's where the relationship is with the district health authorities and the operators of healthcare facilities. Primary healthcare is provided in the community, and we haven't, from a government perspective, had a lot of involvement with that. But I know that the district health authorities work hard to maintain a good relationship with the communities around primary care.
Thank you, and I'm very pleased to hear the deputy's comments in relationship to the interaction that is taking place between provinces and the federal government, because we have to, in relationship to our First Nations, have a better understanding of who is responsible for what and who is doing a good job and who isn't in our First Nations. One of the things that I hear repeatedly at the constituency level is distance traveled and so on. We have, I believe I heard the figure of 39 diabetes centers in the province. How many sites are there for dialysis in the province right now, and how many do you envisage that there will be in 5 years' time? Because you're already talking Digby, Inverness, and other locations.
I'm going to ask Catherine to talk about where they are now. I'm not suggesting that the new ones will be built in 5 years, so don't misread my comments, because we want to concentrate first on the home dialysis. That has to be our first investment if we're going to utilize our money. If you look at the cheapest type of dialysis is home dialysis, next is the satellite clinic, and third is Halifax. So if we can take those resources and provide care for more people where it's appropriate, that's where we're going to go first. But I did indicate that if we get to the point of adding, those communities would be the ones that we'd be looking at. Now I'll ask Catherine to talk about where the existing ones are.
Okay, so again, we have three programs in three what we call in-center programs across the province. And that's where patients would go to start dialysis. And that's in Yarmouth and Sydney and in Halifax. And then we have satellites across the province. And so Halifax Capital Health operates satellites in Liverpool, Berwick, Truro, Spring Hill, Pictou, Anticonish, and Sherbrooke is a collaborative model where the district and Capital Health are working together to manage those two sites. And then we have one at Strait Richmond, and there will be one in Inverness in the spring. Oh, Dartmouth is part of Halifax. And in Sydney, we have also what they refer to sort of as their backup site. And I think it's in North Sydney.
Okay, how do you determine where satellite dialysis units are needed, and how much does it cost to set up one?
I can take, again, as I was talking, historically it was based on distance. It was trying to keep within the 100 kilometers or 100 miles, I can't remember. 100 kilometers for people to travel. And I think Digby is the one I mentioned that's out of sync with that. The second, to set up a satellite clinic, my understanding that the initial startup cost is about $2 million per satellite. That's not counting any operating cost. And then on top of that would be the staff that we have to put in there and annualize the supplies to go with it.
Really delighted to see that you're spending $626,000 just announced by the minister in relationship to home dialysis. Where do we rank in Nova Scotia nationally in terms of the number of patients per capita that are involved with home dialysis at this point?
We're at the bottom, so lots of room to grow.
Okay. And who is eligible for home dialysis, and why aren't more people choosing this option? And what about the trends for the future? I believe that this is a real key that we're zeroing in on here, and there is a lot of room to grow.
I'm going to ask Catherine to talk about the eligibility. The understanding I have is about 80% of our current ones could be eligible for home dialysis. The reasons have been many of why we are not just here but nationally. And having listened to, I mentioned the cafe I attended last week, part of it's cultural that we're attending. The other thing that we found is that individuals who associate with individuals who are on institutional dialysis will continue to want institutional dialysis. The places that have the most success where they've to educate people, they have a separate section where those individuals go to home dialysis and interact with folks who have home dialysis. They're much more prone to take that because they learn the value of it. And as a matter of fact, I think each of you have in your package a copy of this brochure, which just comes out and it's talking about a lady who from Sydney who talks about the advantages of home dialysis to her and how much more freedom she has. She has the freedom to travel. She has travel to do things on her own rather than travel to a hospital to get treatment. So there is, if you start to think about it, how do we help? And that's interesting. Listen to Dr. Tenenmore last week. He was talking about an individual who was afraid to get the flu shot, that over time working with him, that they were able to get him to be able to put the needle in his arm to be able to have home dialysis. But it's the cultural changing, the education. And the other thing, I don't think that we've been as good as a system at promoting home dialysis. We've been much more prone to promoting institutional care, and that doesn't matter what it's for. We love our institutions more than doing better primary care, and we have to change in everything we do to move more things into the community, including dialysis. But the talking about who may not be eligible might be a better way to put it. I'll ask Catherine to speak to that.
Actually, the time's elapsed on that. If everybody would like, we could finish the answer because we have so much extra today. So, and we'll have your answer then, Ms. Fraser, and we'll go to the next round.
So when we look at home dialysis, we in Nova Scotia have had one great benefit, and that's we have one of the better rates of kidney transplant in the country. And so when there's less than a two-year waiting list for kidney transplant, I think that there's been a tendency for us to think that those who are eligible and are going to be transplanted, we wouldn't offer home dialysis. But I think we're changing our thoughts and our perspectives on that. And I think as we've watched other provinces in the country and who they are targeting to talk with about home dialysis, we're realizing that we have a number of individuals in our province that could benefit from that. And as Deputy Minister McNamara talked about the Nova Scotia Renal Program is beginning to do a lot of work so that we can socialize home hemo or peritoneal dialysis through more of a campaign and letting patients know what the options are up front and helping them make better choices. And even though I know Mr. D'Entremont talked about frail elderly not being able to do home dialysis, we do have home care in our province, and there's an ability to have home care assistants and providers go into homes and support patients who would choose that modality. So I think that we do have an opportunity in the province to increase and target, and that will benefit them, patients, in the long run.
Thank you, Ms. Fraser. And as I say, the time had gone beyond, but we have lots of time this morning. So I'd like to turn over for a second round to Mr. Caldwell for the Liberal Caucus, and I'm going to say 20 minutes for both caucuses. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, the Nova Scotia Renal Program Satellite Dialysis Provincial Implementation Plan was done on December 15, 2009. Report indicated that a satellite dialysis unit would be opened at Digby. The report indicated it was particularly high on the priority list for patient need, and the DHA is ready. The report was done 2 years ago. What's the status on that setup?
Mr. McNamara?
Yeah, as I mentioned, it comes down to, again, when we have the resources to move things forward. We are at this time concentrating more on home dialysis, and then when we've done some work in that, then we can look at more satellite clinics. But our first preference right now is home dialysis because we see the biggest benefit to patients and the best benefit for taxpayers.
So is there any indication when the Digby satellite may be set up or
no,
any plans for it at all?
No, there's not.
Also, it indicated that at the Berwick site be consolidated in the Valley Regional, and there's been plans to offer at the Valley Regional both hemodialysis and prenatal. Is that the proper?
Peritoneal.
I'm sorry about this.
That's okay. I have the same problem.
Could you, Deputy, confirm where we are with the establishment of the in-center dialysis in the Valley Regional?
Perhaps I'll ask Catherine to give you the best up-to-date information.
Ms. Fraser.
So again, Kentville was looked at as a potential site for a satellite, but as Deputy McNamara has indicated, there has been no funding to move in that direction right now. So we continue with the existing satellite in Berwick that supports the Kentville area or Windsor or the Valley, Annapolis Royal area.
Also, there's been the same sort of question about the Inverness Hospital. Is there, for a satellite site, there's the same answer there as well?
No, that satellite has been constructed, and that satellite will open early spring of 2012.
Well, that's positive.
If I can add on that.
Mr. McNamara.
Part of the reason was we were doing renovations in Inverness, changing the emergency room and doing some other work, so it made sense to do it all at once rather than going back and do something a second time.
Now, there's also... I would assume your answer to this question is going to be, but I'll ask the question anyway. I can think I know what your answer is going to be. Can anyone please indicate where the province would do with patients that do not meet the one-hour travel time or the 100-kilometer travel time that you talked about? We have patients in the system because that seems to be an issue, I know, in some rural areas.
It is unfortunate there are some individuals that will not, but what our aim is to get the majority of patients within that travel time, and that's where we, but the achievement that we have made. And as I indicated earlier, when we would move to a next one, we know Digby is the one that we would have the first priority in terms of travel time of doing something different. But as we work towards more home dialysis, we hope that we can reduce the reliance on travel at all, and that individuals be able to have the service in their own home.
When you talk about Digby again, how many people are not just Digby, in the province are over the 1 hour travel time? What percentage?
I don't know that, but we can try and get that information for you and Okay. Send it to the committee.
Yeah, if you could supply that to the committee, we'd appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you.
In one area that comes to mind is Eastern Shores. They recommended that St. Mary's Satellite Unit close, and these patients travel to any condition. Has that been finished, or is that going to happen, or what's
no,
the status on it?
There are still patients receiving treatment in Sherbrooke at St. Mary's.
Is that going to continue for a while, or is that?
There's no current plans.
Ms. Fraser.
Thank you. The satellite in Sherbrooke has two chairs, and between Capital Health and the District 7, they have agreed to keep the satellite open as long as there's two patients there. So.
And that's set up just for two patients?
Yes, because you can only do one patient at a time, because you always have to have a backup system in place in case something would happen to the system when one patient is on. But it's a very small satellite, and when the planning was done to place a satellite in Antigonish, it was the burden of illness was looked at in that area, and the traveling distance, and also whether they could recruit and employ staff in Antigonish that could operate a satellite. And so as the population moves and changes, the plan was always that once there were no patients at Sherbrooke, that would close. It's a very difficult area to recruit a lot of staff in, so, and to expand the satellite there wouldn't make sense.
Are there other people in that area that have to travel for dialysis that aren't one of the two seats there, or there is only two people in the area?
There has been, from time to time, individuals who have had to travel to Antigonish. Originally, they were traveling to Halifax, and the district was able to get them closer by getting them to Antigonish. And I do believe there's one individual who would like to be dialyzed in Sherbrooke, but currently there are two patients there. And as I said, you always have to have a backup system, so you can only do one at a time.
And those machines, do they operate around the clock, or just 8 hours a day sort of thing?
It depends on the number of people and the size of the clinic. So, for example, some of our satellites operate 6 days a week, two shifts a day, and others operate 3 days a week, two shifts a day, depending on how many patients there are.
It always seems the healthcare system, a lot of the equipment isn't utilized after hours. And it doesn't make sense. You get the very expensive equipment sitting there. I know it's a resources issue with staff, but it just doesn't make sense, because to go get a test. Personally, I'd like to go at 2 o'clock in the morning when there's not all the traffic and everything. And I know a lot of people share that view, and would mean we'd have to have less equipment, but we'd need more staff. But you wouldn't have a huge capital cost of the equipment. Is there any view in this or other areas of the health that's maybe?
when we're talking about dialysis and we're looking at the burden of disease and the age of the population, we're finding that even doing three shifts a day, that means that some patients have to go in the evening and then they're traveling late at night to home. And so to do any more shifts would not add benefit for patients, because we often hear from patients who are on the third shift that that is a struggle for them. So we try to keep them to, especially in the rural areas, two shifts a day.
I was wondering too, as indicated earlier, that the as common knowledge anyway, I believe that it's cheaper to operate outside of Halifax because the cost in Halifax is extremely high in the Halifax area for operating in those areas. Has there been any discussion about the establishing a unit in the Twin Oaks Hospital in Musquodoboit Harbour that could service the needs of the Eastern Shore and also people that would be going to the Dartmouth General Hospital? They could travel out instead of into the city, which would travel be better, and there's free parking there instead of parking costs that they have to put up with when they go to the Dartmouth General or the QE2. Is there any indication there that might be possible?
Mr. McNamara.
The short answer is no. But also when I talk about the cost, you have to remember that in Halifax, it's not the reason for the cost is the more sophistication and the type of patients that they're seeing and what they have to do. So it's the type of dialysis that is a cost factor, and that's why I said home is cheaper than satellite, because well, obviously when you're doing it at home, you don't have to have a staff there, so that reduces your cost. We would increase our home care to have to do some of it, but no, there's no plans to do Musquodoboit Harbour.
This new in-home system, it's that you have. How many of them do you have out there now?
Oh, Ms. Fraser.
We have approximately 100 individuals on what we call peritoneal dialysis, and there are 15 on home hemodialysis.
And how much would you want to expand that? There's a huge number of people that have diabetes, and not all of them need dialysis, of course, but how rapidly do you want to extend the home in-home program?
So the Nova Scotia Renal Program is working with healthcare providers and others to look at what kind of a target we should set for increasing home therapies, and right now we're at 17%, and we're looking at 20% as a target over the next 2 years.
Yes, and it's an interesting concept of working at being at home, because people are more relaxed at home, and there's all kinds of positive things with that. Now, do the dialysis care centers or the satellite office have any wait periods? Is there any waiting list to get in there to work, or is that to be for treatment?
It's on.
Yes. We, in Truro right now, we have a satellite that is full, and there's about 14 people who are waiting to get back into the satellite in Truro. So for now, they travel to Halifax for dialysis.
Well, that must be that's a long old drive every day, or every day they have to come and back again, and very expensive too for the people that travel.
Just for any of your constituents who travel over 70 kilometers an hour, there is an income tax that they can claim. So just so that some individuals may not be aware of that. I mean, it's always a little help if they know that there is a avenue they can get some money back through their income tax.
Could you provide that information to our committee?
Sure.
In the future? I think that'd be something that'd be quite helpful for some people in the communities. In dollar terms, how much is spent on the provision of dialysis and renal end care in this province in terms of physician costs, hospitalization costs, ER visits, all that sort of stuff?
I'll frame it up first saying it's difficult to get all of the costs associated with a specific disease, but we do have $31.1 million that we spent in 10-11. We'd need to add to that about $6 million in physician costs, and it doesn't include lab tests, inpatient care, and some other costs that are really hard to capture by disease state. We are working on getting the fuller number, but for now, that's what we're estimating.
That's quite a lot of money.
It's a lot.
That's one reason you're going to the in-home system. How much less expensive is the in-home system?
At the in-home.
Would that be Ms. Fraser?
Yes. It depending now on the type of dialysis that the patient would choose, peritoneal dialysis after you're all established at home is about $25,000 to $30,000 per year per patient. And home hemo is more like $40,000 to $50,000 per patient. And then in-center is around $60,000 to $80,000 per patient.
Yeah. That's quite a significant change. What's the budget that you're going to have? What's your total budget for this? Is that the $31 million you talked about for the 2011-12 budget year?
Ms. Penny.
Sorry. That's actually the 10-11 actual costs. We do have 11-12 budget, and I can break it into components for you because it spans across the department. So for the provincial program, the dialysis provincial program, it's $778,000. Dialysis operating expenses in the DHAs is $27.3 million. We also have a budget in long-term care for peritoneal, $94,000, diabetic needles, $291,000. And we have pharmacare costs, which are difficult to budget exactly for because they're based on usage, but the pharmacare costs in 10-11 were $23.3 million. So
quite significant costs.
It's quite significant.
Is it the diabetic care program who determines whether we have a sufficient number of diabetes centers in the province and whether the part of the time, part-time centers are able to meet the all of the Nova Scotia needs?
I'm sorry, Ms. Fraser.
So the Diabetes Care Program of Nova Scotia does work with the diabetes centers. Now, the diabetes centers are operated by the district health authorities, so it would be within their operating budgets that they would have to decide what the length of time it is that the center would be open.
Given the diabetics care program has indicated there's approximately 77,000 adults in Nova Scotia have diabetes, the number of cases growing significantly, as you indicated before, do we have enough resources and capability in the number of centers and the hours of operation centers now to meet demand and demand that will be in the future?
Ms. Fraser.
So I think that, again, diabetes centers are very important in our primary care provision of care. We also are working with family physicians because primary care physicians are very important in helping with diabetes care as well. And so I think that Diabetes Care Program of Nova Scotia is beginning to work a lot more with the primary health care world in regard to collaborative practices and working with family practice nurses and primary care physicians to help have some of the care that's been happening in diabetes care centers happen in family practice offices as well. So I think in the future, you'll see a partnership, more of a partnership of diabetes care centers with family physicians and collaborative practices.
If someone wanted to go on the home program. Is it the patient that requests that, or is it the primary care doctor, or is it the system within the system that requests that change?
Mr. McNamara.
Okay. Hopefully the recommendation would come from staff to the patient. I think that as patients become more aware of it, they will ask for it. As I mentioned earlier, one of the problems that we have not promoted as much as we could have from a department point of view. And as well, the current system sort of encourages individuals to go more into the institutional side than to go into looking at home dialysis. Based on our experience from other provinces, it is telling us we've got to do a better job promoting and exposing individuals to the benefit of home dialysis. But if an individual requested it, we would do everything we could to accommodate them, that's for sure. But I think it's also getting our practitioners to recommend it more is the other thing we have to work on.
Now, if I was going to publicize this in my community, how would I do it? Would I indicate that it's number one, it's available, and number two, that little plant pamphlet?
I can give you some brochures to start with.
Okay, that would be a good start. But if I write it up and I do periodic newsletters and I put it in the newsletter, how do I indicate to people that what's the entrance? If I was at diabetes, how do I enter this if I want to do it at home? In real simple terms, yeah. So people can understand it.
What we can do is ask the renal program to do a little brief note that you could then include in your newsletter.
That'd be fantastic.
That'd be helpful to you. Okay.
That'd be good.
Ms. Fraser?
In terms of patients with diabetes, we know through our diabetes care program that not all patients with diabetes will proceed to have end-stage kidney disease and progress to dialysis. So just to make that clear that all people with diabetes don't end up having kidney failure.
I understand that, but I just want to make people aware. I know I have several people in my community that are on dialysis.
Yes.
Now, none of them may be interested in this, and there's but if I can put the information out there, how they enter it, if they're interested, then maybe they can ask their family doctor or whatever and start the process and indeed give them a better lifestyle and cost the province less money. So it's a win-win.
Exactly.
How much time do I have left?
Actually, I was just about to interrupt you, Mr. Caldwell. Your time has elapsed, and we have the final round of 20 minutes to the NDP caucus, beginning with Mr. McKinnon again. Back to Mr. McKinnon.
Thank you very much. In this province, we're trying to dig ourselves out of a very, very deep hole financially. And we do have a real approach to getting back to balance and fiscal responsibility and so on. So I think it is quite significant that the minister, the department has announced a new $2 million. So I think that accentuates how important it is to be doing more in the area of diabetes. And one of the aspects of that new $2 million involved 12 full-time equivalent RNs. Where will they be around the province? And what exactly is their role? I have a good idea for that myself, but there are people listening at home and so on that I think would like to hear that.
And ask Catherine to respond.
Ms. Fraser.
So the strategy for the registered nurses in satellite units was we were trying to do this because it'll enhance the care that are in satellites, and it will allow patients who have more complex needs to go there and get back to their community. So right now, there is a registered nurse employed in the Berwick satellite, so there have been patients who have been able to return and not travel to Halifax any longer for their care. Pictou has a registered nurse employed there now, and one in Truro. We're hoping to have one at the Strait Richmond site by the end of this fiscal year, and also one in Spring Hill by January. Again, nurses, registered nurses who practice in dialysis units require some training, and also to recruit registered nurses to certain areas is a challenge. But I think that Capital Health has done a great job in moving this strategy forward.
Thank you very much, and pleased to see that there are some brochures available on home dialysis, and certainly every constituency office should have a few of those. Mm-hmm. And I commend you for what you are doing. At this point, I will turn over to again to Mr. Ramey.
Mr. Ramey, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I just have a couple of quick questions on dialysis here. And I may have missed an answer, so if this was asked already, I apologize. When we were talking about diabetes, we talked about the fact that there were somewhere in the vicinity of 80,000 diabetics increasing at the rate of type 2, about 4,000 a year. Am I correct on that? Okay, so I'd like to ask the same question about dialysis. How many, can you tell me how many people are on dialysis currently in Nova Scotia in some form or other?
Ms. Fraser?
We have a total of 650 people having dialysis, and 100 of those are on peritoneal, and 15 are on home hemo.
Okay. So, okay. That's interesting. I would have, for some reason, I thought it would be more than that, yeah. But...
We, through the Nova Scotia Renal Program, working with providers, we know that there's about 1,000 people seeing nephrologists in pre-dialysis clinics across the province. Mm-hmm. So again, the burden is, you know, we're looking at a 3% increase to dialysis starts annually. I think we should also remember that because we have a renal program working with providers, there's a fair bit of work being done to slow the progression of end-stage right. kidney disease. And so we're hoping to be able to sustain the numbers that are starting as well in the future.
Okay. Now, we talked a little bit earlier on, I think Mr. Caldwell asked a question about a waiting list for dialysis, for institutional dialysis. Do we have a waiting list for home dialysis? Do we have people who are just chomping at the bit to get on with this or not?
There have been wait lists from time to time to do home hemodialysis, and I think that's why with the government's investment into purchasing home hemo machines and training and setting up a program in Cape Breton, we'll see those people come off the wait list, and we'll also see more people who will take advantage of it.
So the home dialysis, which we've talked about a fair amount this morning, it fits in with the aging in place philosophy, I guess, where you're able to, you know, not have to leave your home and get the care you need with, and we've seen the economic benefits of that, or we've heard about the economic benefits of that. The $626,000 that we've invested in the home dialysis program, can you just give me a bit of a breakdown of how that's to be spent then? You mentioned Cape Breton, so we're obviously doing something there. Is there anything else you can tell me about?
So in Cape Breton, funding will go for machines, as well as putting in place a staff that will train patients and also be there for backup and support when they have issues.
Mm-hmm.
So that's part of the money. Okay. Then some of the funding will go to Capital Health to purchase more machines, so that at one point they did have a wait list for home hemo. I'm not sure if they do now, but if they do, that will help resolve that issue. Mm-hmm. And then in Yarmouth, we're looking at enhancing their peritoneal dialysis program, because they're just in their infancy stage of beginning to offer home therapies. So some of the funding will go to create a training space, and then for staff and supplies.
So I heard Cape Breton, Capital Health, and Yarmouth in that answer. So it's across.
Yes, across the province.
Not all being spent in one area or something. And my final question before I turn it over to Ms. Epstein, and this is a bigger question, and I guess it's a question for Mr. McNamara, and I hope it's not an unfair question, but in some of the remarks Mr. McNamara made, and I totally agree with him, he mentioned that we have to work on this shift from seeing the institution as the answer, the big expensive building place that you go to, as opposed to other ways of accomplishing the same goal, but maybe in the final analysis, not only more cost effective, but might be a much better solution. So my question is, how much progress do you think we're making on that? I mean, have you seen any indications at this point that people, the general population out there, are getting it, that they're seeing that the institution isn't the answer to everything, and that other ways of doing things may be better alternatives than what they were used to? Is there any, have you seen any change in the culture on that at all, or are we stuck in the same place as we were when we started?
No, we are seeing some progress. We got a lot more to go. For example, with our CEC that we opened in Parsborough, for example, where individuals can now get to see a physician the same day or the next day, we are having individuals traveling the 100 kilometers that they won't go for dialysis to go to see a doctor now because they can get in faster. So that's one example. I think as we work through more of that, and the emphasis has to be how we put more resources from acute care into primary care, as we're setting up our teams, as we're, for example, when we look at collaborative practice with nurse practitioners and physicians, and individuals, if they can get access to a health provider, they are much more satisfied. If they can do it quicker, it also prevents illness from getting worse, because it's the thing that we're looking at through our physician manpower plan, which the report will be coming out soon, will help us to decide where we can encourage physicians to locate to be able to do more primary care. That, and we do know that, in this province we have, and it's no secret, too many specialists and not enough GPs, and we've got to start reversing that trend.
Thank you very much, and good luck in that quest. And I'll now turn the remainder of the question to Mr. Epstein.
Mr. Epstein, please.
Thank you. Most of the questioning today, for obvious reasons, has focused on the treatments available for people with renal problems and diabetes. And I have to say that the efforts of the department are very impressive. It's obvious that a lot of effort is going into coming to grips with this. What I was curious about, however, was the prevalence rate in Nova Scotia. It seems to me in some of the background materials, Nova Scotia was identified as the province with the second highest prevalence rate. I think Newfoundland was the other province, the province that had the highest prevalence rate. And what I don't understand is why that should be. Is there anything you can tell us about why it is that there is such a high prevalence rate in Nova Scotia?
Ms. Fraser.
So, I guess one of the things I could say about that is with the good work that the diabetes care program is doing, as well as what providers are doing, we have patients or people living with diabetes longer. and you know, managing their disease better, so they're living longer. And so with the growing incidence and then people managing themselves, we're having a bigger prevalence, a greater prevalence.
So you're saying that the better we get at dealing and coming to grips with the disease, it just adds to the prevalence,
yes,
rate?
Yes,
is there nothing about the initial occurrence? I guess it's the initial occurrence that I'm wondering about.
Yes, so the incidence is what we need to deal with, and we need to really move upstream again, as we heard here this morning from many, that what we really need to deal with for people who acquire type 2 diabetes is that we need to start working early around how people are living in regard to their diet, in regard to their lifestyle, not leading such a sedentary life. And again, that doesn't help everyone not get type 2 diabetes, but for a large number of the population, we need to change how we're living to help us not get into a situation where we acquire diabetes.
I guess, in fact, that's the real focus of, mm-hmm, of what my concern was. I'm wondering about steps that either individuals can take or that the department can take along with other entities like schools and so on to try and prevent the onset of the disease in the first place. So you're pointing to exercise and diet. Are these the main factors that we should be aware of?
Those are the two major factors, yes. And I think and it's not within my branch that this work is done, but certainly the Diabetes Care Program works with the wellness part of the Department of Health through public health and healthy living, helping to encourage Nova Scotians to take a look at what they're eating and how much activity they're getting.
Is it also fair to say that to some extent it's poverty and housing related?
Definitely the social determinants of health play a role in how people are able to eat and provide for themselves.
Yes. Okay. Well, that's a big help. Thank you very much for that. And thank you for the presentation today. Very interesting. Thank you.
Are your questions exhausted
for all
members?
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I appreciate that, and actually had extra time for us today, so that was good. Thank you so much for being here today. I'll give you an opportunity if you'd like to make any final statement or wrap up, Mr. McNamara.
No, just to thank the committee for the opportunity to come here and present this information, and we do appreciate the opportunity to be able to talk especially about home dialysis and to start the communication of that to the public. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'll just note there's been a couple of requests for further information, and our clerk will be in touch with you to just double check what each of those are. There seem to be four items. And thank you very much today. It's been very informative, and this is certainly an issue that affects many Nova Scotians, and one that we'd certainly like to see the incidence and overall numbers drop over time. Thank you. For committee business, if I could for a moment, there is some a notice that we've received information from Labor and Advanced Education, and we just like to note it there in case there are any questions further. We have an updated list of confirmed meetings, and our last meeting that we've got scheduled is February 8th. Yes, Mr. Epstein.
Thank you. I notice that there is a meeting scheduled for the 25th of January. The Department of Transportation is due in that date.
Right.
I've actually just become aware that our caucus is planning a retreat for that date, or that will cover that date, and so our caucus won't be available for the 25th, and I'm wondering if we can try and reschedule around that. So I'll leave that with you and the clerk, if I may.
Very good. That's good to know. Thank you so much. And I think beyond that, we have our next meeting in January, and I wish everybody a very good holiday. Thank you. Adjourn. A motion to adjourn. Thank you, Mr. Caldwell.